Hi everyone, it's Lindy. Today is January 31st, and that makes it one full month of my experience selling with Amazon FBA. So since it has been a full month, I wanted to do a little video about the top 7 crucial things that I feel like I've learned since I've sent in my very first Amazon shipment. So hopefully going through these 7 things will help you if you are looking to get started with Amazon FBA, or maybe you've just gotten started with Amazon FBA and you just haven't learned these things yet. So when you first start a brand new platform, there's gonna be dozens of things that you start to learn right away. And I'm not going to talk about every single little thing that I've learned over the last 30 days of selling on Amazon, but what I am going to do is highlight the top 7 things that I feel are the most important to know. The first thing is that the buy box price is crucial to sales. Now, I know that you hear lots of people talking about buy box this, buy box that, I'm gonna hold the buy box, I'm going to drop to the buy box, I'm going to raise the buy box, all of these buy boxy kind of terms, and it's really hard to understand exactly what it is, let alone how important it is. But I've seen firsthand that having the buy box is crucial to getting sales, even if it's just the difference of a few pennies. So there was one day, now first of all, I don't have more than 100 active SKUs within Amazon right now. I think last time I looked, it was like 80 something SKUs. I have a whole bunch that are waiting to be processed, but as far as active SKUs, there's only like 80 something right now. And at the time I only had about 50 SKUs, and there was a whole day where it got up to be like 6 o'clock in the evening and I had not had one sale. And since I'm still new to Amazon, I don't know what's typical, what's strange, but up until that point, every single day I had orders processed in through Amazon, I was having consistent sales. So it already felt a little bit weird that it was 6 o'clock and I still hadn't gotten any sales. So I went in just to kind of take a look at my pricing. And I noticed that a couple items that I had sold previously that weren't selling anymore, my price was actually a couple of cents higher than the buy box. So all I did was lower my price 2 cents to hit the buy box. And I kid you not, within 20 minutes, sold 3 items. So it just goes to show that buy box is crucial for sales. Now, that's not to say that you should always get the buy box. So this I know is gonna be something that a lot of people have difference of opinion about, but the buy box price could end up breaking you or eating into your profits if you drop too soon. So the buy box could lower or the buy box could go up. Which is another reason why a lot of people use repricing systems, which I just subscribed to a repricing tool yesterday. I don't think I did it right. I'm gonna have to go in and mess with it. I was trying to wait to use a repricer until I had a little bit more items in, because you do have to pay for those services. And if I was gonna pay for a service, I wanted to make sure that I had enough items active to make it worth it. So there are repricing tools that will go up in price or down in price if you want to compete with the buy box. You could set minimums, maximums, and all of that. But the problem with the buy box is if people are battling with price and the price starts dropping, if you automatically want to hit the buy box every single time, if the buy box was higher when you bought the items, and let's say you paid $9 for an item and you were expecting to make $15 back, but then the buy box started rapidly dropping. And so now if you hit the buy box, you're actually only going to get $8 back, which is actually a loss. So it might be wise of you to hold your price and not race for the buy box right away. Wait for everyone else to sell theirs first. And then when the buy box goes back up, then you can sell your item. When you do that though, you do have to worry about storage fees. So it can get very, very complicated. But the whole point of this is it is true. The buy box is crucial for sales. If your price is higher than the buy box, then it doesn't matter how good the rank is on an item, your item won't sell if you don't have the buy box. Okay, so the next thing that I learned is that Amazon can ship your items to different warehouses without you knowing it. So when you go to create a shipment for FBA, Amazon can ask you to split your single shipment into multiple shipments to multiple warehouses. I'm not positive, but I'm fairly certain that the reason why they do this is because they want to have a more even amount of similar items at each warehouse. That way, when Prime customers purchase it, then the likelihood of it being at a warehouse that's closest to them is higher, so that they can ship the item and get it to the buyer within the 2-day time period. So they do a lot of the times like to scatter items across all of their warehouses, and you as the third party seller, they want you to do that for them. But what I don't understand, what I find quite frustrating, is that I go to the hassle of splitting up shipments to go to other warehouses and paying a little bit extra because when in shipping, because when you have a great big shipment, the more weight it is, the lower the price is gonna be because you're maximizing the shipping weight. But when you have to break it up into several shipments, you end up paying a little bit more in shipping because smaller boxes will cost more per item to ship in than one massive shipment going to the same location. So as a third party seller, that's extremely frustrating because, you know, you break up your shipments and you send them to the designated warehouses that Amazon wants you to send them to. But then they turn around and they ship your item wherever they want to anyway. So that's very, very frustrating. So I first learned this when there was one item that I sent in, I think it was like a quantity of 13 of something, and it had said that there was only 9 available and 4 were, what did it say? It was like requested or held or something. There was 4. And I had Googled it and looked it up and come to find out that requested or whatever means that it's likely being transferred from one Amazon warehouse to another. So what Amazon did is they received all 13 of my items and decided that they wanted 4 of them to go to another warehouse. So 9 of my 13 items were active, ready to be sold, and 4 of them were hanging around in limbo while Amazon transfers them wherever they want them to be, which is frustrating again, because if you wanted 4 to be at that warehouse, why didn't you tell me? I would have sent it there and all of my items could have been active. But now I can only sell 9 of the 13 items while the other 4 wait around to go to another warehouse. So I don't know why they do that, but they do that. I mean, let's face it, Amazon can do whatever it wants to. It's a beast. But just know that that can happen. So just because you send all of your items to a particular warehouse doesn't mean Amazon's not going to decide to send some of it somewhere else. And they don't ask your permission. They just do it. Something else that I learned that I figured was pretty crucial when it comes to sending in shipments is I was under the impression in the beginning that every single shipment, you had to include every single thing in one box. So I thought that as the third party seller, now I know a lot of this is probably gonna, if you're more experienced than I am with Amazon, it's gonna sound really silly what I'm about to say. But I thought that as the third party seller, you were responsible for making smaller shipments so that all of your items would fit in a single box. So I thought that if you had entered in 200 items, if you couldn't fit all 200 items into one large box, that you were gonna run into problems. And that's not the case. Come to find out, you can break up a single shipment into multiple boxes. So if you wanna sit down and enter in 500 things into the Amazon database, and you need 6 boxes to package all 500 items, that you can do that. You just need to, when you're creating the shipment and putting in all of the box weight information so that you can print your labels, you just need to tell Amazon how many boxes are included, and it's gonna ask you, like, if there's more than one SKU per box, you put the total number of boxes, and then you put all of the box measurements and weight, and then you can print multiple labels for every single box. And the labels will just say, like, if you have 6 boxes, the labels will say box 1 of 6, 2 of 6, 3 of 6. You just need to make sure that you put the proper label on each box relevant to weight. So if you have one box that's 30 pounds and 1 pound, or one box that's 40 pounds, you have to make sure that you put the correct labels on those boxes. But otherwise, they're all a part of the same shipment. They're just split into multiple boxes. Once I learned that, Shipments became a lot easier because I didn't necessarily worry about only entering in the amount of items that I could fit in the boxes that I had on hand. Once that was taken out of the equation, I was able to just do large batch shipments and just enter in hundreds of items all at once because I knew that I could split them into as many boxes as I needed. So I found that to be crucial information. So the fourth thing that I learned is about sales rank. So you always hear people talking about how important sales rank is when you're considering an item for FBA. But something that I had kind of assumed was that sales rank was more about how fast something was going to sell. But come to find out, sales rank is more about how often something will sell. So I used to think, okay, well, if it has a sales rank of under 100,000 in this category, that means it's gonna sell within a month and I won't have to worry about paying storage fees. But come to find out, yes, that is true, that you can kind of gauge rank and figure out how long something is gonna sit around. But also for replenishable items or an item that you can buy a multiple quantity of, like let's say you're shopping at the Target clearance section and there are 20 of a particular toy and you say, oh, this has a really good rank, I could buy this. But the next question would be, okay, so you know it's gonna sell fast because it has a good rank, but how many of them are selling every month? Should you buy all 20? Are all 20 gonna sell in the first month? Are they only gonna sell 5 a month and then you're gonna be paying storage fees for the next 4 months? Sales rank helps you gauge that. So not just how fast something will sell, but how often something will sell. And there's a really super handy calculator that AMZ Scout has. I'll put that link in the video description. But it's a really handy calculator where you pick the category of the item and the current sales rank, and it gives you a rough estimate of how many times that item sells in a month. So if it's a toy and it's ranked 58,000, you just enter those two things in and it'll tell you, oh, this sells approximately 126 items per month. And then from there you could say, ooh, well, there's 20 of these, I'll just go ahead and buy all 20 because that rank means that over 100 should sell. So all of these should be gone within a month, easy peasy. The next part of the sales rank that I found to be really important was when I first started, I had thought that sales rank, gauging your sales rank was like flat across the board. Like ranks under a million were good in books and ranks under 100,000 were good for every single category. But that's not the case. So not only is sales rank important, but the category is equally as important because what you want to try to do is stick with the top 3%. Again, this is just my experience and what I have learned thus far. It's really good to stay above 3% in a category. So what you do is you look at the category as a whole and where the sales rank ranks within that category. If you want to try to stick with, let's say, top 3% of a category, you have to look at the category as a whole. And each category varies, but as a general rule, I just have a little chart right here that I'm going off of. I don't believe it to be accurate, but I'm just looking at it for numerical purposes. Let's say you want to sell something in the baby category. So the baby category has around 10 million active items. That means that the top 1% is just over 100,000. 100,000. So as long as you stick with 100,000 or under, that is the top 1% of the baby category. That means that stuff is going to sell frequently and it's going to sell fast. And if you're looking to stick with top 3%, then that means around 300,000 and under is gonna be top 3%. So it won't sell as frequently, but it should still sell really, really well. So you start to get into the iffy kind of territory when you're hitting the top 5% and top 10%. Because even if it's top 10%, the item will sell, but you're probably gonna have to deal with storage fees because it's not gonna sell too frequently or fast. But top 10% will still sell. So that just goes to show that when you're paying attention to sales rank, the category is just as important as the number itself. So make sure you're paying attention to both. And again, I will link the full-time FBA document where it kind of shows you the top 1%, 3%, and so on for every single category. So the fifth item that I wanted to share was something that I think is very, very crucial, and I don't hear a lot of people talking about it. So I don't know if this is something that people just like don't want to talk about or what, but come to find out, just because you're restricted on something doesn't mean that you can't sell it. All you have to do is request. So let me go into a little bit more detail here. So when I got that giant pallet, there was quite a few items that whenever I would scan it with the Amazon seller app, it would say, you cannot sell this item in new condition. But it would tell me I could sell it as a collectible, I could sell it used, but I couldn't sell it in brand new condition. So I'm kind of like, I can sell it used or I could sell it collectible, I can't sell it new, what? So what I did was I went to the desktop computer, I typed in the barcode, and you have to hit the little button that says request approval. And all I did was hit that little button and I was instantly approved. I probably increased the number of items that I could sell out of that pallet that I got. I probably increased 100 items just because I went through the tedious act of typing in the UPCs and just hitting request approval. And I was instantly accepted, and I was able to sell those items on Amazon. Now, that being said, those are for items that aren't huge name brands. If you're talking about things like Nike or certain categories that are really restricted, like baby items or toys or like Fisher Price or just any really super big name brand, it's not going to be that easy. If you want to become unrestricted in those items and be able to sell those, you have to do the legwork. You have to provide invoices. You have to get certain written permission. You have a waiting process where you submit everything and they go through things. It's a lot more difficult than that. But there are some items, they weren't really big name brands. Even some of the items were, I don't even think there was brand names. All I had to do was click request and it was instantly approved. So just because something is restricted, as long as it's not a huge name brand company, don't be scared off by it. At least try to click the little request button, because chances are you'll be instantly approved and you'll start be able to sell even more than you expected to, just because you went that extra step to click a button. So the sixth thing that I learned is kind of a bummer, but it's a part of selling on Amazon. And that is that Amazon really will snatch your money for a return without asking anything first. So in my first 30 days, of course I got a return. So far I've only gotten one return, but I didn't even know that that return was requested. That just goes to show that you really have to pay attention to your reports and you have to go search for that information, because Amazon did not tell me that a return had been opened for an item that I sold. The only thing that I found out about was when Amazon emailed me to say, we took that money back. And boy, did they. They snatched it right out of my account. No questions, no asking. It was just, the money was gone. I didn't even know that there was a return open. So if a buyer opens up a return, Amazon will take that money and you won't have any idea. So make sure that you're paying attention, because they don't ask you first. They don't notify you. They just do it. And then the seventh and final thing that I have learned over my last 30 days starting on Amazon FBA is that it takes forever to get paid. Forever. And then on top of that, even when it's your first payout, they will still hold the majority of your money as a form of insurance to make sure that you're not gonna have a bunch of returns. So as of today, right now, my sales are a little over $2,500, and my first payout, this is me being real with you guys, okay? I'm not gonna actually show you, you're just gonna have to take my word for it, just trust me. So as of today, my sales are right around $2,500 for the month of January. But my first payout is only set to be $171. Yep, $171 is what my first payout's gonna be out of $2,500 in sales. There is a lot of money that is being held as a form of insurance to make sure that customers don't have issues. Now, a lot of that also has to do with the fact that I have sent in so many shipments. When you print the shipping labels for the shipments, they automatically draft the money from your seller account to pay for these shipping labels. So a big chunk of money is also taken out because I've been sending in so many shipments, and that's kind of something to be expected. You know, it happens when you aren't getting a ton of sales, but you're sending in a whole lot of shipments, you're gonna start having to pay for all of those shipping labels to get your items to Amazon's warehouses with the little money that you have started making from sales. So, in saying all of that, something that I want to make sure that everybody learns is that if you are going to start doing Amazon FBA, it is not only capital intensive for buying merchandise to send into Amazon FBA, but it's very capital intensive when it comes to you send out all of these items and you don't get your money back for a really long time. So it's not like with eBay or Poshmark or Mercari where you sell the items and then within a week you're able to pay yourself funds. Or, you know, with PayPal, the money's instantly in the account and you're able to access it. It's not that way with Amazon, at least in the beginning. When you start getting going on Amazon, I know that you can request more frequent payouts, but as a new Amazon seller, I think I can only get payouts twice a month, and they do hold a lot of money as insurance to make sure if there's problems that they're going to be able to get their money back. So that means that as a new seller on Amazon, I'm probably looking at a good 3 months before I'm starting to see any sort of return. Because right now on Amazon, the profits that I'm making from the items that are selling are kind of just like paying for the shipping labels for all of the new items to go in. And then that capital is all kind of tied up because it is really capital intensive selling things on Amazon because things tend to cost more. It's more expensive to source for Amazon. So I'm just gonna have a lot of money tied up for a really, really long time. So I don't want anyone to think that you're gonna start Amazon FBA and the money's just gonna start rolling in, because yeah, it looks really awesome. You know, I've got $2,500 in sales. I'm probably pocketing at least half of that after fees. And that's not the case. My money is tied up, it's sitting around, and I'm just waiting on it whenever Amazon decides to release it to me. So that's one of the more challenging parts of getting started on Amazon, is not having your money and having to wait to get paid for a very, very long time. All right, you guys, those are the 7 most crucial things that I feel I have learned in my first 30 days of selling Amazon FBA. What have you learned? Are you new to Amazon FBA? Are you a super experienced Amazon FBA seller and you just watch this just for the fun of it? I want to hear what you guys have to say down in the comments below. If you've just started, if there's anything new you have learned, please feel free to share that information, because I love when we all kind of learn things together. That's what these videos are all about. And if you're more experienced at Amazon FBA, what things do you think I didn't talk about that maybe I just haven't learned yet, or things that are crucial that we all do need to know about? Please leave it down in the comments below. Please don't forget to subscribe and give a thumbs up for more content. And don't forget to check that video description. I'll put useful links in there, as well as the AMZ Scout link and that little PDF from Full-Time FBA for all of the categories on Amazon. And thank you guys again so much for watching. I will see you with my next video. Bye.